A series here on the weekends called Healthy, and where we're looking at what it means to be healthy people, because God has called us to be a healthy people. We get some wrong ideas in our heads about God, and we don't think necessarily that God wants us to be happy and healthy, but that really is the case. Sometimes we get caught up in a theology that says God wants us to suffer. He went to the cross, and we should take up our crosses, and God just wants us to suffer and die to ourselves and give away and give up our selfishness. And those are all true things, but not because God wants us to hurt. God wants us to be happy, and God wants us to be healthy. God wants to give us full lives and whole lives. Look at the life of Jesus. Did he go around making people hurt, or did he go around healing broken people? He went up to people who had been disabled since they were born and restored them to full health, working miracles everywhere he went, because he wanted people to be healthy. And we forget that. We don't see all of God through the lens of Jesus. Sometimes we forget that. We see God through the lens of guilt or bad experiences we've had. God loves us, and God wants us to be healthy. We don't associate miracles with church, unfortunately. When we think of church, we think of far more mundane things. We think of, you know, potlucks and mission trips and youth groups and sewing circles and old songs and new songs and baptisms and weddings and funerals and friends and meaning in life. We think all kinds of things, but we don't think of miracles because those are weird. We seem to have left that off in the past somewhere. There was actually a Scottish philosopher a few hundred years ago named David Hume who wrote a book arguing that miracles couldn't happen because, and here's the deep philosophical argument, nobody had seen any in a while. And that really was the argument. And the miracles, you can't depend on stories about miracles. They must not happen. We don't associate church with miracles anymore. But honestly, look at what Jesus did. Jesus went to people whose bodies were broken and restored them to full health. And he taught them things that restored their relationships. And that's really a miracle when that happens too. When enemies become friends, that's a miracle too. And God wants to work miracles in our lives, real miracles today. And God wants us to be healthy. We're in the series called Healthy Now. If you haven't picked up one of these cards, you can pick this up on the way out today. It's got the list of all the different kinds of healthy we're talking about in the weeks to come. And so you can put that on your refrigerator to remind yourself. If there's one topic in particular that you're interested in, make sure you're here that weekend. Follow along at reallife.la to our podcast. And if you've got a friend who's one of those health nuts, you know, somebody you see at the gym all the time, or somebody who's looking to be healthy, give them one of these cards and invite them along. That's a good way to invite them. And I want to address one more group that's here this morning before we get into our study of God's Word, because I know you're here. I saw you coming in, rolling your eyes, right, dragging along behind your family. There's some dads here who aren't normally here, maybe Christmas, Easter. And this weekend, Mom said, what I really want is for you to go to church. And you thought, I'm just going to check that box. She knows you, and she knows she's probably going to hell is what she's thinking. So she's trying to get you here. She cares about you, and she's trying to get you, and you're here, and you're thinking, I'm just going to check that box, make her happy, Wi-Fi it. And you're thinking, good, I'm done. I'm just going to sit here. This guy won't bother me too much for the next half hour, right? And your fear is, this is going to turn into kind of like a define the relationship talk. You came here, and I'm talking about healthy relationships today. I really sprang that on you, and you're just waiting for that moment when I ask you, how you're feeling, right? And so I know, dads, I know you're here, and I know that you may have just come against your will, but I have something for you, too, if you're a dad and you're not real sure about the church thing. Let me ask you this, dads. Do you ever have that moment where your kid comes up to you and asks you a question that you honestly have never thought about before? And you look at this kid and you think, how is that big thought trapped in that tiny body? And you try to look for a way to get out of it. They come up to you and they say, Dad, what about all the religions in the world? What do you do with that? Are they all right? Are they all wrong? What do you do with that? And, like, you know, you've never written an essay on this. You think, Or they come up to you, and you know, it's a modern world. They come up to you and they say, "Dad, there's a kid in my class at school who has two moms. What does that mean?" And you think, "Well, I don't know what to say. I don't want to be a jerk, and I don't." Right? Well, we're having a new gathering for dads over the next 4 weeks to answer those questions. It's called The gathering is called On Thursday nights, starting this Thursday, you can get one of these little cards on the way out. It's got the topics we're talking about. We're going to meet 8 p.m. this Thursday night at City Cafe. Come over to a pub, hang out for the evening, and we're going to talk about hard questions that kids ask their dads. So, dads, there's something for you, too. Now, how do you feel about that? Okay. What I want to do today, though, is talk about relationships. We are talking about what it means to be healthy, and part of our healthy lives is healthy relationships. And because, moms, you are a mom by virtue of a relationship, that is in the definition of mom, I want to talk today about what it means to have healthy relationships. The Bible has this profound truth that it gives us about relationships. Because the Bible really has an eye on changing our lives by changing our relationships and changing our community. There really is this teaching in the Bible which, if we all applied it, would make the gathering of Christians called the church become this radical place that all the world would stop and look at. If we all did this together starting this morning, people would be fighting to get in the doors in here on Sunday mornings. I'm not kidding you. I'm not exaggerating. When you watch TV and you see people making fun of the church or making fun of Christianity, when the news is reporting on terrible things that Christians have done, when sitcoms are making fun of Christians and religion, we can't get all that mad at them. Because honestly, they would not be able to make fun of us if we were known as the most loving organization on earth. They just wouldn't. If the church were known as the most loving organization on earth, no one would want to make fun of us. But we are not known as the most loving organization on earth. I think we're supposed to be. I honestly think that's what Jesus wanted. I honestly think he wanted us to be so defined by our love for him and one another that people would fight in the doors to get near that kind of love. I really think that's what he meant. I think that's what his life teaches us. I think that's what his teachings teach us. I think that's what the Bible says. And the Bible has this prescription for healthy relationships, which most of us have missed. And if we did it, it would be a different world. Open in your Bibles to Philippians chapter 2. Philippians is this little letter in the New Testament. You can turn it on or open up. There's a guy named Paul who lived in the first century world. And he went around leading people to Jesus and starting churches. And he would move into a city, gather Christians around him, start a church, and then he would move on to another city. And then the city he left would write him a letter asking him more questions about what they were supposed to do, and he would write back. And 13 of those responses from Paul are in the Bible, are in the New Testament. And one of those was to a city called Philippi. So this is Paul's letter to the Philippians. And Paul loved the Philippians. Some of his letters are just angry at the things that the church is doing. But he loves Philippi. He loves the Philippians. They're a great church. They're great people. He's proud of them. He's happy when he thinks about them. And so he writes this sweet letter to them. And in chapter 2, there's this little, it looks like a poem. There's this little poem in there that we now think is one of the songs of the early church. It's sometimes called the Christ Hymn. And it tells you really where the heart of the early church was, because the things you sing about are the things you care about most. And so the early church wrote this poem, probably this song, that describes what's most important to the early church. And Paul here quotes it in Philippians. And in quoting it, he's going to teach us something profound about relationships. Look with me in your Bible at Philippians chapter 2, starting at verse 1, and listen to the word of God. Therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and of one mind. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. So the goal of our relationships is unity. The goal of our relationships together is unity. This is very different from the politics of the suburbs in which when you don't like someone, you try to cut them out of your circles. When you know someone who has offended you or thinks things that you don't agree with, you try to make sure that they're not included in the invitations and the events, that you go around in the community and you gossip to your friends about them, so you poison the community against them. You do everything you can to make sure that person gets left out. Does that sound familiar? I remember hearing a comedian say, the reason we have laws against murder in this country is because without those laws, there would be so much murder. Because as a species, we're kind of nasty to each other. And you may not go around killing people, but Jesus says when you hate people in your heart, when you go to cut them out of your world, cut them out of your society, it's the same. That's an evil place in our hearts. But that's the politics of the suburbs. We go around trying to leave people out. Look at the life of the Apostle Paul. That's exactly how he lived. He believed that the Jewish faith from which he came needed to be pure, needed to be protected. And any false teaching and any bad influences needed to be kept out and cut out. In fact, before he became a Christian, he was killing Christians in order to protect his religion. The first Christian martyr, Stephen, was made a martyr by Paul. Paul killed him. Because Paul believed you have to keep your religion pure, you have to keep your circle pure. And if any impurity gets in, any false teaching, any bad behavior, if anything bad gets in, you have to cut it out. You have to keep a pure inner circle. That was Paul's life. And then something happened. He met Jesus, and he went from killing Christians to creating Christians. He went from being the muzzle of Christianity to being its megaphone, and he went around spreading Jesus' love everywhere, specifically to people that he always before had thought were unclean, people that he had always left out and cut out. Those were the people to whom he went. When Paul went into big cities like Corinth and Ephesus and began to talk about Jesus, it'd be like your grandmother going into a nightclub. He was a fish out of water, but he went specifically to the people that he had always tried to leave out before. And that's what the Bible calls us to. The Bible calls us to unity, to kind of reaching out into a broken world and including people in a fellowship that is unified in one heart, one spirit, one mind, and one Lord. In order to understand this, you have to have sort of an island mindset. I used to live in Hawaii, and in Hawaii, you have kind of an island mindset. When you come to a stoplight, and there's a car in front of you that's stopped because the light is red, and then the light turns green, and that person doesn't notice, you don't honk your horn. You sit there. It's a green light. There's a person sitting in front of you. You sit there. There's somebody behind you, and nobody honks because it's an island. The person in the car in front of you is probably someone who knows you. And if you honk at them, they're going to be mad at you. So you don't. You're polite because you might see them again later. If they're not someone you know, they're probably the cousin of someone you know, and they're going to go tell their cousin that you sit there and honk on your horn. So you just don't. You have an island mindset of things. Your assumption is that you're going to see everyone again sooner or later. So people are very courteous in Hawaii. Los Angeles is a little bit different, I've noticed. There's a lot of honking in the city, because when you think, 10 million people, I'll never see you again, right? I have the feeling that heaven is a little bit more like Hawaii than Los Angeles, actually in a lot of ways. Yeah, pretty sure when I get there, I'm going to recognize it. I've been here before. Yeah, this looks familiar. But honestly, heaven is the same way. Heaven is an island. Heaven is a kingdom that goes on forever, and you see everybody on and on and on forever. Everybody who's followed Jesus, who loves Jesus, you're going to see them for the rest of eternity. And I know some of us have that mindset. They're probably going to be there. I'm going to stand at the other side of heaven. I'm just going to make sure I don't see that person too much. That's not how it works. You and I are going to be face to face for the rest of eternity. If we believe in Jesus, that's where we're going. It's going to be our home together for all eternity. It's going to be a shame if we have to spend the first 500 years going, sorry, I was such a jerk. Right? So Paul calls us to a kind of unity now where we love each other, where we're of one mind, of one spirit, of one heart, and one Lord. Paul calls us to that kind of unity now, so much so that the world around us should look at us and go, wow, they really love each other. That's the kind of relationships that the Bible teaches us to have. Now, this is very different for some of us, because some of us think, okay, so the purpose of my religion, the purpose of my beliefs is to keep my world safe. I'm going to keep outsiders out and insiders in. I'm going to keep bad influences out. I'm going to keep purity in. And so what I'm going to do is I'm only going to hang out with people I know are trustworthy and loyal and faithful. And the trustworthy and loyal people that I know, trustworthy, loyal, faithful people that I know, I'm going to start with Christians. I'm going to leave everybody else out. I'm only going to hang out with Christians. And then, you know, there are a lot of people out there who call themselves Christians, but I'm not really sure they are. So I'm going to keep it down to my local church. Only the Christians that I know because I can keep an eye on them. Only Christians whose kids are not going to be a bad influence on my kids. I'm going to keep the circle small. Well, now that I think about it, even at my local church, there's some people who are questionable. So I'm going to make the circle even smaller. I'm going to keep a tight little circle. Basically, only the people who can sit in a row with me at church. That's it. It's going to be that, just our row. That's going to be my circle of people that I trust and say, look down your row right now. Look down the row at the people sitting next to you. See, they look a little sketchy too, don't they? Right? You're not real sure about them either, are you, right? Eventually, if you keep whittling down to this pure, safe inner circle, it's just going to be you in there. And if you think you belong in that circle, you're not being very honest. That was the mindset of Paul. I'm going to keep the faith. I'm going to keep the religion. I'm going to keep the behavior. I'm going to keep it safe, and I'm going to keep it protected. I'm going to keep an inner circle. That was not the calling of Jesus. And no one was more free than the Apostle Paul after he met Jesus. All of a sudden, Paul was in all these broken and dark places in the world, talking to people who would have never followed Jesus before about who Jesus was, about what Jesus' death on the cross meant, about what his resurrection meant, and about life with him forever. Paul was going to all kinds of places that he would have never gone before. And that's the image of the church that God has for us. It's not a little club that we keep safe. It's more like a school, where we teach people what it means to follow Jesus as we ourselves are students, where we are apprentices of Jesus, learning to follow Jesus as we invite others to do it too. That's the image of the unity in the kingdom that God calls us to. The goal of our relationships is unity, that we would have this loving community unlike anything else that's always got room for one more. And then Paul says, here's the means to achieve that unity. The means of achieving unity is humility. He goes on in the text at verse 5, Philippians chapter 2, 5. He says, in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. The means to our unity is humility. Be of one heart, one mind, one spirit, one Lord. Viewing others as better than yourself. Putting others' needs before your own. The way we do this is by following simple instructions that we tell kids when they're crossing the street. Little kids, we tell them, stop, look, and listen. And that is the recipe for a humble life. Stop, look, and listen. First, we have to stop. And that means we have to stop talking. And usually it means we have to stop talking over other people. When you're in a relationship, when you're in a family, and you get in that place where it's kind of heated, where it's kind of hot, bite your tongue. Honestly, it's the hardest thing in the world to do, but it's so graceful. Parents, spouses, if you can bite your tongue and let that other person speak first, you will be heard better if you listen first. I will be heard better if I listen first. Say it with me. I will be heard better if I listen first. Right, first. Stop. It's so hard to do, but so valuable. I remember this one time, my wife taught me this really valuable things about relationships. She said, Jim, one of the most important things about relationships is, and then I didn't hear the rest of it because I interrupted her and went ahead with what I wanted to say. And now I have no idea what's the important about relationships because I lost it. See, now if I had not interrupted, I might know. As it is, I'm still learning. The first thing we need to do in relationships is to stop ourselves from talking over other people, because the things that we think and feel are not more important than the things that other people think and feel, right? So the first step to do towards humility is to stop. The second thing to do is to look. And by this, I mean you need to look at the other person for who they are and validate who they are. When we're in relationships and things get a little bit tense, get a little bit heated, we really focus in on ourselves, on what we're feeling, on how we don't feel heard, on how we feel hurt, and we want to get that out. But stop and validate who that person is. Stop and look at who they are. Do you ever have that moment when you're a kid with your brother or sister and you're in that fight, you know, you're mad and you've got all kinds of things you want to say to your brother or sister because you know where the buttons are and you're going to push all the buttons. And right when you're in the middle of that, mom or dad walks up behind your sibling. So you can see mom or dad and they can't. And they're still firing guns at you and all of a sudden you're the sweetest person on earth because you can see mom or dad standing behind and you know that that's their kid too, right? And you're a little concerned that they might be the favorite. So mom or dad walks up behind them and all of a sudden you get really, really polite because you know who else is in the room. Well, do this. When you get to that place where things are tense between you and somebody else, stop and picture Jesus standing behind them, because he is. And know that that person is a child of God. Know that God loves that person. Before you start firing at that person, think about how much God loves them. Stop and look at who they are. Think, this is a child of God. And see if you can hold on to that rage just enough to validate them. There was actually a famous preacher about 100 years ago in the UK named Campbell Smith. And he's actually a very famous preacher in his day, well-known name in his day. And he had four sons, all of whom became well-known preachers themselves. So they were this established family with five well-known preachers in the family. And one time somebody asked, Campbell Smith asked him, who's the best preacher in the family? You know, and all the boys are there listening in, so he's not sure who they're going to pick. And without missing a beat, the dad said, Mom. Mom's the best preacher in the family. Because he saw her for who she was. And he saw how her influence had shaped the kids growing up. Mom is the best preacher in the family. Stop and look at people for who they are and realize that they are valued children of God. And then finally, listen. Stop and authentically listen to each other. Listen to each other and talk to each other face to face. We have one of our rules on staff here as a church is when we disagree, we have those disagreements face to face. We don't go talk to other people. We don't gossip. We don't triangulate. We don't manipulate. We have conversations face to face. And the first thing we do is to listen. Because listening to somebody, it gets you the right to be heard. It validates who they are. And it creates the kind of unity and humility that God means for us to have together as a people. God's call on our lives is humility, because when we're humble, we can be unified. And as we are unified together, we might become that body that Jesus came to create, that body of people who love him and love one another so much that people are fighting to get in the door. Wouldn't that be a beautiful thing? Wouldn't that be healthy? Let's pray. Father, I ask that your spirit would settle in our hearts this morning. For anybody who is struggling in relationship, I ask your peace. I ask your healing. I ask your wisdom and your direction. God, work in our relationships that we might honor you with them, that our relationships with one another might be a reflection of your love. Teach us to stop talking over each other. Teach us to see each other as children of God, and teach us to listen. As we do so, may we become the church. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.